Dear students, good morning. Today we will discuss about torque equation, back EMF equation and its significance. In previous two classes, we have discussed about the basics of DC motor, construction of DC motor. Now we will discuss about very important concept of the torque and back EMF, because it is required when we will discuss the characteristics of separately excited DC motor. So in DC motor, we already discussed in detail what is the principle behind this, and where we have seen the current carrying conductor is placed in the magnetic field and it experiences a mechanical force, and the magnitude of this force is given by F equal to VIL, and it will produce a torque to rotate the armature, and this rotating the machine shaft. Now we want to calculate the expression for this torque. We will calculate this torque in a single conductor, and then we will multiply it by the total number of the conductors to calculate the total value of the torque developed in the armature. So it's a very simple 12th class formula. If we are writing the torque, then is the R multiplied by the F, and we put the value here. Here you can see from this figure, R is the distance. You can see the R is the distance from the conductor axis to the force point. It's the force point. And it's a magnetic field here. L is the length of current carrying conductor, and I is the conduction current, or you can say the conductor current. So this I, because in armature, there are the A number of parallel paths there. So this armature current is basically is given by the conduction current, because it is in a single conductor, and multiplied by the number of parallel paths. So in this way, our conductor currents becomes equal to the armature current divided by the A parallel paths, because A is here the number of parallel paths. So we put this value in equation number 1, and we see now phi is the flux in per pole. Phi is the flux in per pole. We already discussed the 4-pole machine. It means the number of poles are exist more than one. So if I am saying the phi is the flux per pole and p is the total number of the poles, then total flux will be p phi, and it is acting on the armature current. That is given by, because the flux is nothing but the magnetic flux density multiplied by the area. So we can calculate the flux in this. Now I put the value of B in equation number 3, and after putting the value, we were getting the torque in per conductor. This is the in a single conductor, which is the P is the number of poles, phi is the flux, I is the armature current, and A is the number of parallel paths. But in the practical DC motor, we know the number of paths is very high. So here we are represented that by the capital Z. So the total torque developed in the armature was given by, we will multiply the equation 5 with the number of Z. So this becomes equal to this equation. You can see here Z is nothing but the number of total conductors, and P is the number of poles, A is the number of parallel paths. For a DC motor, if a motor is already designed, in this case everything is, and the number of conductors is fixed, number of poles is also fixed, and the number of parallel paths is also fixed. So we can say it is a constant. So this is represented by the constant Ka, and it is the flux and it's the armature current. So it is the torque equation. Now we will discuss about the back EMF. You know, in the DC motor, when the armature of DC motor rotates under the influence of the driving torque, the armature conductor moves through the magnetic field and hence the EMF is induced there. And the induced EMF acts in the opposite direction of the applied force due to the Lenz's law. And that's why it is known as the back EMF, or sometime we will call it the counter EMF also, and it is represented by EB. Now we want to calculate the value of back EMF. So to calculate the expression of back EMF, what we will use? We will use the Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, and according to that, we know the EMF is equal to nothing. EMF is equal to the rate of change of the flux. So this is the Faraday's law. Here what we are supposing, phi is the flux per pole, p is the number of the poles here, z is the number of conductors here, and n is the speed of armature in RPM. So rotation per minute, we are taking here per minute, not per second. So you have to pay kind attention for this also, because when we are solving the numerical problem, that time we have to take care about this particular point. And A, we already discussed the number of parallel paths, and for that we already discussed in our last class. What we have discussed in our last class, when we are talking about the armature winding, then there are two type of the windings. One is the lap winding or another is the wave winding. And we know in the lap winding, this number, the parallel path is equal to the number of parallel path is equal to the number of poles, or for the wave winding, the number of parallel path is equal to 2. So these are the things which we have to use here to calculate the back EMF equation. You can see what will be the flux change in the flux, because in single pole is the phi flux, so in the P poles the flux is the P phi, and time for one revolution. So if you decided the speed of armature in RPM, then it means this becomes equal to 1 upon n, but it is given in the RPM, so n is divided by 60. So it is nothing but 1 upon n upon 60. So we can write here 60 by n here. Then EMF induced in one conductor, I am talking about here one conductor, so put the value of flux as well as the time here, and you are getting this equation. Now we are talking about the EMF in one parallel path. We are taking the one parallel path, because if we have more, so many parallel path, doesn't matter, because in the parallel path voltage is constant, we know. So in one parallel path, if we are calculating EMF in the one parallel path, that is equal to the total EMF. So in one parallel path, we have to take care how many conductors are connected in series, and that number is given by Z by A. Yesterday class we already discussed this matter. If again this is important here, if we are talking about lap winding, then A is equal to P, and when we are talking about the wave winding, then it is equal to 2. So we have to take care that it is nothing but the number of conductors in series in each parallel path. So I put this value here, and this is nothing but the total EMF. Now I will develop the relation between back EMF and angular velocity of rotor also. So what we are doing for that, we are nothing doing, I am multiplying 2 pi in the upper side and 2 pi in the downwards for in the denominator here. So you see this So in this condition you can see this is Z again is the, what was the Z? Z is the number of conductors, P is the number of poles, and A was the number of parallel path and 2 pi. So it is, this term is again constant. If once a motor is designed, that that particular situation, it is a constant. So it is constant. Phi is the flux. Now what is this? It is nothing but the speed per second, because we divided here by 60, and that is multiplied by the 2 pi, so it becomes in the radian. So it is nothing but the angular velocity. So it is given by the back EMF equation is the constant here, then the flux and omega. Omega is nothing but 2 pi n upon 60, and it is the radian per second, which is we call as the angular speed of a rotor. So, and the equation char is, the equation 4 is nothing but it is the back EMF equation. Now we want to see what is the significance of back EMF in DC motors, that we want to see here. So there are two main application of the back EMF in DC motor. One is the energy conservation, one is the energy conversion, and second is the DC motor as a self-regulating machine. So these are the two applications of back EMF. You see here the equivalent circuit of a armature winding. So in this equivalent circuit, what we are drawing here is, this is not, V is nothing but the supply voltage, and IL is the line current here, and you see it is the armature current here. And in armature we have already seen it is the back EMF, and according to Lenz's law, the direction of back EMF is just opposite to direction of the supply voltage, and RA is nothing but the resistance of armature. So it is the equivalent circuit for the armature winding. Or from this you can see the supply voltage is equal to the back EMF plus armature current multiplied with the resistance, armature resistance. And from this you can calculate here, what you can calculate here, you can calculate here the armature current value, and that is given by this. When we are discussing the significance of back EMF, we must know about these two equations, because when we are talking about the significance, then you have to know about these two equations. What is the relation between torque and flux and armature current, as well as the back EMF and angular speed and flux. So it is very important. So from this figure, what we can see here, back EMF is just opposite to armature current we are seeing here. So some electrical work has to do for creating this armature current against the EB. And for that, the total energy requires, and that total energy requires is converted into mechanical work, and this work is useful to drive the mechanical load. So the first significance of back EMF is nothing but it is the help in the electrical conversion to mechanical conversion. Second is back EMF makes motor self-regulating. So we want to see from this, taking three cases, how it helps to make a motor self-regulating. If there is a first case, if motor running at no load, it means there is no load. If there is no load, so in this situation we require very less torque. And we know from the relation between the torque and armature current, we know when the we require the less torque, it means we require less armature current. And we also know the armature current and back EMF are inversely proportional to each other. So in this situation, what will be happen? This back EMF will be increase here. So internally, in this case, when motor is running no load, this back EMF is nearly equal to the supply voltage. But when we are coming the second part or the second situation, when suddenly the load is increases, when suddenly the load will increases, then the speed falls down, the speed will down. And we can see again from the relation between back EMF and the angular speed of the rotor, the back EMF is directly proportional to the speed of rotor. So in this situation, back EMF will decrease. When the back EMF will decrease, then again the armature current will increase, because both are the inversely proportional to each other. And if armature current is increased, then the magnitude of torque will also increase here. So what is happening in this case, when suddenly we increase the load, so the magnitude of torque which we require is again maintained with the help of the back EMF. Now with the third case, when the load is suddenly decreased, in this case what will be happen, the speed will decrease, the speed will increase because the load is decreased here. And when the speed is increasing, then the back EMF will also increase. And when the back EMF is increases, you know, the current, which is we are saying the armature current, falls down. And in this case, torque is reduces. So this torque is reduces again due to back EMF. So in all three conditions, what we can say is the back EMF in the DC motor regulates the flow of armature current to maintain the load requirement. So this is all about the back EMF and its significance and torque equation. I think you understand about these concepts, and if you have any query, you can write a mail to me on sham@gwac.ac.in.